We are coming to the end of 2 Samuel. That's right. We're finally coming to the end. I don't know how long we've been in it, but I can tell you this. When we started the first book of Samuel, 1 Samuel, in our notes, we're on page 227, okay? And now that we're finishing, we're on page 369, all right? We've been quite a ways in this and a lot of learning, but we'll be going very soon into the book of 1 Kings, okay? Let me ask you some questions tonight. This will be based on 2 Samuel chapter 13, chapter 15, chapter 18 that we dealt with last Wednesday. See if you were paying attention. Maybe you jotted some of these things down. Lots of questions for you tonight. David would suffer disastrous consequences in his family because of sin, true or false? The answer is true. Very good. Let me ask you tonight, who was Amnon? Who was Amnon? David's son, correct. Amen. All right. Number three, Amnon had a shrewd cousin by the name of Jonadab. True or false? True is right. Amnon pretended to be sick to set up a trap against Tamar. True or false? True. Amnon committed a disgraceful sin and violated Tamar. True or false? That's true. That's right. David was angry about this, but did nothing about it. True. Shame on him, right? He should have done something about it. Amnon decided to do the honorable thing and to marry Tamar. False. Very good, church. You're paying attention. Very good. After Amnon committed his lustful pursuit, he took care of Tamar. False is correct. Amnon still loved Tamar and later wanted to marry her. Are you sure? All right, you're right. It's false. Okay. Hey, a lot of folks don't know this, but this is what we went. This is what we studied last Wednesday. Okay, it's a good thing to be in class. WOLBI, right? It's like Bible school, Bible college, Bible teaching, and a lot of people don't know this, and you know this, and I'm proud of you. Amen. All right. Tamar wore a coat of many colors that represented what? Her virginity. Very good. After Amnon violated her, what did Tamar do? She tore it. That's right. And she what? Put what on her head? Ashes on her head. Right. Very good. Absalom would get revenge and kill Amnon. True. How long did Absalom wait until he plotted to kill Amnon? 2 years. Very good. Absalom was a good son and never revolted against David. False. Absalom was known as a sweet talker. Yes, true. How long did Absalom talk to the people and give them promises if he were the king? How long did he do that for? 4 years. Very good. Man, you guys are on it. I am really proud. I'm impressed. Absalom told the people what they wanted to hear. True. Absalom stole the hearts of the men of Israel. True. This might be a little tricky. See if you catch this, because I think I only touched on it one time. Where did Absalom go to declare that he was now the king? Very good. Very good. That's right. Hebron. Hebron is right. Very good. Very good. Absalom was a humble and obedient servant to David. False. What psalm describes David's heart during this crisis in his life? Psalm 3 is correct. Absalom violated David's concubines. True. That's right. David left 10 concubines behind when he left the palace, and he violated them, which is a very, very, very humiliating act, a very shameful act against and towards David, which was prophesied. Remember that? Yeah, by the prophet Nathan that this would happen. Okay, what David did in secret would happen to him openly, okay, with his concubines. How did they capture Absalom? He had long hair. That's a good reason not to have long hair. Amen. I'm messing with you. Tyra caught up real quick on that. Hallelujah. Brother, you get caught up in a tree, you'd be in trouble then, wouldn't you? Amen. Amen. When David heard the news of Absalom's death, he was happy and relieved. No, he wasn't. He grieved, didn't he? That's right. He grieved and mourned over the situation there. And the commander of the army had to go and straighten him up and say, look, people sacrifice their lives for you. Let's go to 2 Samuel chapter 24 tonight. Look at verse 1. chapter 24 and verse 1 in your Bible if you would like. We're going to be dealing with this. It has 25 verses in it. That's the last chapter of 2 Samuel. Also, we can see this in 1 Chronicles chapter 21. Story somewhat like within the Gospels. Information is given here in chapter 24 of 2 Samuel, but also there's more information given in 1 Chronicles chapter 21. Again, it says in verse 1, the anger of the Lord was aroused against Israel, and he moved David against them to say, go number Israel and Judah. And so the king said to Joab, the commander of the army who was with him, now, he says, go throughout all the tribes of Israel from Dan to Beersheba and count the people that I may know the number of the people. And Joab said to the king, now may the Lord your God add to the people 100 times more than there are, and may the eyes of the Lord the king see it. But why does my Lord the king desire this thing? Verse 4, nevertheless, the king's word prevailed against Joab. In other words, you go do what I told you to do. I'm the king. You do what I say, okay? And so he wouldn't listen to them. Prevailed against Joab and against the captains of the army. Therefore, Joab and the captains of the army went out from the presence of the king to count the people of Israel. Okay, let's talk about this here tonight, chapter 24 of 2 Samuel. And this will be concluding if we can get through this tonight. If not, we'll finish it up next week and go into 1 Kings. In this chapter, David is nearing the end of his reign over Israel. We know that David had reigned in Israel for 40 years. David is preparing to transfer the kingdom to his son Solomon. And we find in this chapter that David decided to do something that was foolish. He decided to take a census of all the fighting men that he had in Judah and of Israel and all of the tribes. He wanted to know how many men he had that could fight. Now, I know this seems a little like a harmless thing. What's wrong with taking a census to find out how many fighting men you have in your army? It seems harmless. I know to the non-spiritual man or to the natural man, they would see nothing wrong with doing this, but the problem was God told him not to do such a thing. This was outside of the will of God. The reason being is that God wanted David to put his trust in him, just the same way that God wants us to do. God wants us to put our trust in him and not in the amount of men that he had, okay? So, you know, again, the Bible talks about this. I don't have it on the monitor here, but it says some trust in chariots and some on horses, but we'll remember the name of the Lord. We'll remember the name of the Lord our God. God wants, it's no different today in the New Testament as it was in the Old Testament, no different today in the time we're living. He's the same God yesterday, today, and forever. God changes not, the Bible says. And you look out and you read the Bible, the Old Testament, you read it all the way through the end of the New Testament, and you'll find the thread in there. God is concerned about our faith, and God wants us not to look at the circumstances or the situation or how big or small your church might be. God wants us to trust in his holy name and believe him by faith. God always moves by faith. Faith is the key that unlocks the door to all the blessings that we have through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. David, who was chosen by God, David was anointed by God. David, who was God's choice, God's man, called by God, anointed of the Lord, but David, who knew better, and yet, listen, he knew better. Now, we're not talking about someone that's new in the faith. David's been walking with the Lord for a long time, even though David knew better, but yet he chose, again, it's a choice, he chose to disobey God. And even later in years of his life, as we see here, what am I saying? I'm saying the devil never quits, no matter how old you are. I mean, he's going to try to bring you down. He's going to try to tempt you. He wants to try to get us to step outside of the will of God for our lives, whether we're young or whether we're old or somewhere in between. What am I saying here? I'm saying that we never leave Ephesians chapter 6. You never leave without the armor of God. You put on the belt of truth. You put on the breastplate of righteousness. You put on the helmet of salvation. You carry the word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit. You put on your shoes of the preparation of the gospel of peace. Amen. You never leave without your armor. And that all that armor we talk about in Ephesians chapter 6 represents Jesus Christ. In other words, you never let your guard down. You got to trust God by faith, believe God by faith, hold on to God by faith, because you know what? Bible said the devil will come at an opportune time. That's right. He might come when you're weak. He might come when you're low. He might come when you're lonely. Not when you're on the spiritual mountain of your journey with God, but he's going to wait until you're alone in the desert, in the valley, but you put on that armor. Amen. I know this. My Bible tells me that God will never leave you and he'll never forsake you. You trust trust the Lord. Amen, church. You need to hear that again tonight. God said he'll never leave you nor forsake you. Hallelujah. You put your faith in the Lord. You love God. Lord will be with you. He'll help you. He'll guide you. I know we have good days, had my bad days. I realize that. But God will be with you. Now, we know that through the scriptures, Satan tempted David to give in to sin. But we also know that God allowed Satan certain latitude into David's life. Now, we're going to learn some things about this tonight, because God knew and saw that David, what was wrong with David? David, even the latter part of his life, became lifted up in pride. Now listen, this can happen to us. It can happen to good people like you and myself. It can happen to good godly men and women that have walked with the Lord a long time. We have to be careful that we don't become lifted up in that spiritual, religious, or that pharisaical kind of pride where we think we know it all and then we're not teachable anymore. No, we're always learning. We got to stay humble and broken. That book is eternal because God's eternal. You'll always be learning. God will always be teaching you. So have a humble heart before the Lord and have a teachable spirit, and God will lead and guide and God will teach you, okay? But David became lifted up in pride. Now, Joab was David's commander of the armies of Israel, and he knew, even Joab, who wasn't a very spiritual man, not Joab, he was a warrior, if you will, but even Joab knew better and was trying to protect the king from making this foolish mistakes. And he knew that taking a census was wrong and tried to persuade David not to do this thing. Joab said that, David, listen, David, you've got 100 times more men than what you had before. Nevertheless, get this, David would not listen to Joab. And imagine that, not listening. Imagine that. Jesus said, he who has ears, let him hear. Imagine that. There are times when God tries to warn us, and he sends people our way to try to warn us, to try to tell us, but sometimes we don't listen. Amen. Sometimes we don't listen. We've all done this. When your parents tried to tell you something and we wouldn't listen, and your parents finally said, well, they're just going to have to figure it out for themselves. Isn't that right? Sometimes that's the way it is. In this walk, in this journey with the Lord, you might have a pastor, a teacher, a godly man or woman try to instruct you, tell you, teach you, lead you, guide you, maybe give you some advice, and you don't want to listen to it. Sometimes God says, you know what? They just got to learn on their own. And that's what's happening here with David. Even David, after all these years of walking with the Lord, he still fell into the trap here. And there are times when God will send people our way to help us. We can be stubborn. We can be obstinate. I know I'm not talking to anybody here tonight. I realize that. But, you know, other people can be stubborn. Other people can be obstinate, but not you at Word of Life. Of course not. So it took nearly almost 10 months. Almost 8 months. Oh, yeah, there you go. That's right. That's right. Point that finger there. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But it took, the Bible said, nearly 10 months for Joab to complete the census. And Bible said this, it said, then Joab gave the sum of the number of the people to the king, and there were in Israel 800,000 valiant men who drew the sword, and men of Judah, which is the two southern tribes, were 500,000 men, and so there were over 1 million fighting men in all. In fact, we have 1.3 million fighting men, 1.3 million men of Israel. That is incredible. That is a lot. But listen, if you go to 1 Chronicles chapter 21 and you look at the numbers are a little bit different there. The numbers say that there's 1.5 million people altogether. And so there's a little bit of discrepancy there. Now, not with the Word of God, but with translation, okay? It's not with the Word of God, but with translation. And so, but anyway, nonetheless, there were a lot of people, over 1 million, 1.3 to 1.5 million fighting men. But it was after David received the census that the Bible said David's heart condemned him. Okay, what happened there? The Holy Ghost smote his heart. Why? Because David knew that he had done wrong. He knew it before that. But you know how we are. We try to justify it. We try to make it sound like it's okay. This is an honorable thing. You know, I've got to find out how much. I've got to take inventory. I've got to find out how many fighting men we have, because that's the proper thing that the king should do, but not if God said not to do it, okay? So he stepped outside the will of God and did his own will. So the Holy Ghost smote his heart. Thank God that he did. Listen, if you sin and you feel good about it, you're in trouble. I want to say that again. If you sin and you, somebody help me out here tonight. If you sin and you feel good about it, you're in trouble. But if you sin, it could be the slightest of little things. It could be a bad thought. It could be talking against somebody, whatever it might be. The Holy Ghost, if he smote your heart, that's a good place to be. Amen. That means you're listening to God. That means you're sensitive to the Spirit of the Lord. But that means God chastens those who he loves. God chastens his children. Just like when you have children, they stepped outside of the will of their parents and you had to chasten them. They disobeyed. You had to chasten them. Didn't feel good for the moment, but it yields the peace. Help me out. The peaceable fruit of what? Righteousness, right living, living righteously, or living right according to the will of God. Living holy according to the will of God. So thank God. There are people that come to me and say, Pastor, I did something wrong and I feel horrible. And I said, that's good. That's great. I'm glad you feel horrible. They look at me like I'm kind of crazy. That's good. That's God chastening. That's God loving you. That's God trying to bring you back into right alignment. And that's God bringing you back on the right path. So we can go to the Lord and we can ask God to forgive us, and thank God that we can do that. Now, let me ask you this tonight. Have you ever done something outside the will of God? Have you ever done? Sure we have. Yeah. We, even as Christians, you mean? Even as saved people? Sure you have. Yep. Yep. And you knew that it was in direct disobedience to God. Someone even tried to even warn you. Someone tried to tell you this would not be right or be wrong. And maybe a friend or a pastor or a teacher, whatever, tried to warn you, tried to give you spiritual advice. But you know what? We did it anyway. We justify and we did it anyway. And when you did, right afterwards, you felt terrible. You felt convicted. The Holy Ghost immediately dealt with your heart. And then you thought, how could I be so stupid? Somebody help me out here tonight. Why did I do that? Why? What was I thinking? And then you walked around for days or weeks feeling miserable. But thank God that you can go to him, and thank God that he forgives. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thank God that we can. Amen. Full hallelujah. Don't let the devil tell you that God won't forgive you. I want you to know that right now. Don't let the devil tell you that God won't restore you. I'm going to tell you, the blood of Jesus is sufficient. It's called grace. Amen. It's called grace. Hallelujah. And it's the grace of God. Not that I'm giving you a license to sin. Paul deals with this in the book of Galatians. Not giving you the freedom or an excuse or the license to sin, but thank God that his grace covers all of our sins, and we can be in right standing with the Lord. Now, if we continue in sin, if we continue going in a direction of disobedience, eventually that will catch up to us. And I believe there is a time where we can actually walk away from the Lord. Our hearts will become hardened and we become calloused, and our conscience becomes seared. That's a dangerous place to be. How do you know when your conscience is seared? How do you know that? That's a good question tonight. Wouldn't you want to know the answer to that? How do you know when your conscience is seared? I'll tell you what. When you can sin and you feel okay with it. When there's no conviction. That's a dangerous place to be. Now you're getting to a place where your heart is calloused, and you're getting to a place where your conscience is seared. And that's a dangerous, dangerous place to be. And a lot of people do that today. Think they can do whatever they want, live like the world, still saved. God's okay with it. God's not okay with it. They say them and God are tight. No, you're not either. God's not tight with any sin. Let me say it again. God is not tight with any sin. Okay? All right? Bible said that the word of the Lord came to the prophet by the name of Gad. By the name of Gad. Okay? He was a prophet and a seer. And the Lord offered three things to David to choose from because of his sin. Number one, 7 years of famine. That's a long time. I know in 1 Chronicles 21, it says 3 years of famine. But I'll go with this right here. 7 years of famine. Number two, or run for 3 months from his enemies. Number three would be 3 days of plague in the land. So David would put himself in the hands of God. He didn't want to be put in the hands of man. And so he put himself in the hands of God because God is merciful, because God is just, because David knew that God, he's righteous, he's holy, he's God, that he would do what is right. Because of David's sin, God would allow a plague to spread throughout the land. And before it was over, 70,000 men died. 70,000. 70, that's amazing, 70,000 men died because of the consequence of David's sin. 70,000 people died. It is incredible to think about the number of people. Then according to the word of the Lord, David would offer a sacrifice unto God. He went to Arana, the Jebusite, okay? And Arana was willing to give the wood and the oxen to the king for nothing, for free. But David would not take it for nothing. Not at all. He would not offer any sacrifice unto God unless it cost him. The Bible says that after David offered the sacrifice, the plague was withdrawn from Israel and the plague stopped. Okay, now let's go to 1 Chronicles. At least you can make a notation there. 1 Chronicles chapter 21. And it also sheds a little bit more light on the subject. Verse 1 says, now Satan, of course, who is our adversary, stood up against Israel and moved David to number Israel. Now, with the scripture, we're able to see behind the spiritual curtain to see what really is happening and taking place. Now, understand this. It wasn't God that tempted David to take a census. It was the devil. God did not tempt David. It was the devil. But I want you to understand this. Maybe you want to jot this down. I don't think I put this on the monitor, but just try to understand this. The devil simply tempted David with something that was already in his heart, okay? It was already there. The sin of pride was already in his heart. God knew that. God saw that, okay? So the devil simply tempted David with something that was already in his heart. God did not directly provoke David to do something for which he would then turn around and later judge him for, because then that would be an unjust God. That would be unjust. God does not tempt, okay? He's not temptable, but he also does not tempt according to the book of James. But rather, this is what God did. God allowed Satan to influence David to do what David already had in his heart to do. God did allow this. Satan moved upon the pride that was already in David's heart. So in other words, sin lied at the door. So God allowed Satan to have certain latitude into David's life because of the pride that was there. Now, God is not the initiator of evil, but only that which is good. So what do we understand about God? Well, we know that God is good. God is pure. God is perfect. God is holy. God is flawless. God cannot make mistakes. God never wearies. God never tires. God is perfect. He knows all things at once, instantaneously, everything. I don't know how to explain that to you, but God knows all things, okay? He knows everything. He's intrinsically pure, true, he's good, he's holy, and he's impeccable. God does not learn by his mistakes, because God never makes mistakes. God's sovereign, God's in control, and God calls the shots, not the devil. So that means that the devil cannot do a thing to us unless God were to allow it. The devil can't do anything to me unless God were to permit or at least give consent to it, okay? How do we know that? We see that perfectly here in the book of Job with Job's life. Satan already had his watchful eye on Job. In fact, Job was the conversation in heaven between God and the devil. But the devil was not allowed access into Job's life because God had a protective hedge around him. Remember that? But the devil says, if you take that down, he'll curse you to his face. Remember that? But God did allow the hedge to be brought down to a certain degree to where Satan had certain latitude into Job's life. He could touch him, but he could not kill him, okay? Now, he lost his sons, he lost his daughters, he lost his business, and then although Job was stricken with disease, he had boils from the top of his head all through his body to the bottom of his feet. We see, and although his wife told him to curse God and die, we find here in the Bible that Job did not curse God. So guess what? The devil doesn't know anything. Guess what? The devil was wrong. Job did not turn against God. Job did not curse God. The devil doesn't know everything. In fact, Job said, I know that my Redeemer lives. That's what he said. He said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Isn't that amazing? Praise God. I know that Job learned a lot through that. I know there was anguish in that. He learned a lot about God. He learned a lot about himself. Sure he did. And we all do when we go through trials and the fiery trials of our faith. But God is in control, not the devil. Listen, we don't need to be afraid of the devil, but we need to fear God. The fear of the Lord is missing in the church. And we need the fear of God back in the church again, back within the saints of God again. Amen. Okay? Amen. Now, Joab tried to persuade David not to do this thing, but David wouldn't listen to him. Even though Joab knew it was wrong and it would be displeasing to God, he knew, but not David. Now, interesting, isn't it? What happened here? How could David not know, even though Joab told him? In all the years that David walked with God, how could David not know? I'll tell you how. Because pride had blinded David's eyes. Pride. Folks, listen to me. Pride gets in the way. And it kept David from seeing the truth. That's why we have to empty ourselves out to God. How do you know if you have pride? by the way you react if you don't get your way. Amen. Isn't that right? By the way you react if you don't get your way. If you don't get your way and you react in a way that's, you know, not a very good way to be pleasing unto the Lord or give glory to God, then there's the issues of pride. Now, let's be honest with one another. We all have the issues of pride. We all have it. I'm not standing here before you and telling you that your pastor never has any issues with pride. Sure, I do. I've got this fallen, demic flesh just like you do, and I have to fight with it, deny it every day just like you do. Pick up your cross, pick up our cross with you just like you do, you know, and to follow Jesus. But the thing is that we're in a dangerous place if we don't admit it. If we don't admit that we have failures, if we don't admit that if we don't admit that we have pride, God, listen, that's when pride creeps in, is when you don't admit it, when you don't acknowledge it. But you can go to the Lord, and I do it many times. God, help me. God, forgive me. God, cleanse me. God, wash me. I know I'm sinful. I know I have this sinful nature, but I don't want that to rule and reign in my life. I don't want that to control me. God, I want you to rule and reign in my life. I want you to lead and guide me. I want you to help me. Don't let me fall into sin. Don't let me stumble, oh God. Don't let me become full of pride. Amen. There are times when I've cried out to the Lord, when I feel like I don't have a burden for the lost like I need to. Instead, I'm criticizing and putting people down for their way that they're living. But they're lost. They're in sin. They're blind. They're disconnected from God. And here I am criticizing them. No, God needs a people that will show love and compassion and mercy and that will intercede and pray for them. Amen. But pride gets in the way. You know, I thought, Lord, here I deal with these issues. I don't know if other pastors and so forth deal with this, but I listen to other pastors, Brother David Wilkerson preaching, and thank God I heard him talking about his pride and how he can get in the flesh so quick and that he can get so upset or so angry, and he's had to apologize so many times to people. And here's a pastor, and I'm like, oh, thank God I'm not alone. Amen. Praise God. Not that misery loves company, but I'm just seeing such a righteous man and a holy man of God that God used so greatly to touch the world with the gospel of Christ. But yet he struggled with these issues too. What am I saying? I'm saying the devil tempted him too, just like the devil tempts us, like the devil tempted David here. Oh, but someone might ask, what did David do that was so wrong? Well, listen, my friend, the sin of David was very subtle. It was sneaky, it was sly and devious. In fact, most of us have fallen into the same trap. David had put his trust and confidence in himself and in the numbers rather than in God. Lord Jesus, Lord God, I need to quit preaching on this tonight. I'm feeling convicted. Lord, pray for me, church. Pray for me. Pray for me. It's hard. I said, pray for me. Hallelujah. Yes, ma'am. Yes, it does. Well, it does. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes. Yeah. It does. It. Yes, it does. Yeah. 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 You can change the scriptures for your liking. That's right.
He's still working on me.
Oh, you're. Yeah.
When something comes in my life,
yes.
God already knows.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. But. Yeah. Or others. Yeah, blame God or others. But the thing is that if it can happen to David, now, okay, let's take this. Then, so why do you think that the Lord allowed Satan to be the thorn in Paul's side to buffet him? Why do you think that happened? Now, Paul had revelation after revelation of God. What did God, and Paul prayed about this three times. And God said, my grace is sufficient for thee. Now, the thorn in his side was sent from Satan, okay? But God was in control of it. God was in control as to how much pressure the devil was allowed to do in Paul's life, okay? Or whatever it might be. But it was to keep Paul humble, because he could become very lifted up in himself after all the knowledge and wisdom and revelation that God had given him, and was a very powerful apostle. I mean, you're talking about Paul who rebuked Peter. Paul the apostle rebuked Peter because when Peter was eating with the Gentiles, the uncircumcised, and then when some of the group came from Jerusalem, James clan there came up, Peter jumped the table and went to eat with the Jews real quick. And so he's playing the hypocrite. And Paul confronted Peter to his face in front of the people. Wow. Wow. Called him out. What would happen if we did that here? What if your pastor were to call someone out right in the middle of the service? Woo, my goodness gracious, huh? Lord God, have mercy. Lord God, have mercy. Amen. Yeah. 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 Yeah, yeah. There's our power. Then the blood. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. The blood of Jesus. Amen. It's very true. So this is really good. I think we can identify with this tonight. Wouldn't you say? I can identify with this. So this chapter is very, very, very powerful. So David had fallen into the trap that depended on Israel's number of fighting men for his strength and victories rather than putting his faith and trust exclusively in God. Now it's hard for us to get this, but we look at the natural, we look at the circumstances, we look at the wind and the waves. We look at the checking account. We look at the bank account, and there have been many times through the history of this church when there's something that I wanted to do here in this church, and I'm looking at the checking account, and the checking account says, no, there's no way. But I'm going to tell you that, but from the very get-go, from the very beginning, everything that we did in this church, we really tried to follow the Lord in planting this church, and we really tried to be led by the Holy Spirit. And whenever we did something that we knew was God, we knew was the Lord, God always provided. God always provided. Now, if it was my idea and not God's idea, and I tried to get the church behind me to do something, I couldn't get 2 cents. I couldn't get 2 pennies. Nobody would help. I tell you the God's honest truth. And so guess what? I quit trying that, right? But if it's the Lord, I know the people will behind it. I know that. And God will bless, and God will help, and God will strengthen, and God will provide. And so God parts the sea, doesn't he? God helps us, all right? But we have a tendency to look at the bank account. We look at this situation. We wonder, oh, God, you know, but God wants us to trust him. But the numbers had nothing to do with Israel's victory, nothing to do with David's victory, because God was the one who fought their battles. And it's still God that fights our battles today. As God told Moses, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, and the Lord God will fight for you. Hallelujah. And that's what God was trying to teach Israel, and that's what he's trying to teach us. God will fight for you. God will fight for you. I feel like I got to say it again. God will fight for you. But trust the Lord. We're going to put our confidence in God. Hallelujah. Amen. It was by the nostrils of God who parted the Red Sea, and they walked across on dry ground. It was God who gave Israel their victory over Pharaoh. That God stood between them with a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire or by night, or really during that time when Pharaoh was coming after them, there's a pillar of God's presence, a cloud that showed darkness on the side of Pharaoh and light on the side of Israel as God had parted the Red Sea. Hallelujah. It was God who brought down the Jericho walls as they obeyed the Lord, and they shouted when they were supposed to shout, and they blew the trumpets when they're supposed to blow the trumpets, and the walls came down. It was a miracle. It was God who parted the waters of the Jordan River, who's a type of the cross of Calvary, and they walked across and brought into the land of promise. The church needs to stop looking at numbers to see how great they are. And that's what they're doing today. They think that they're great if they have big numbers. That's not true. You might be like the prophets of Baal. You've got a lot. You've got 400. You've got a lot of commotion, but you don't have fire. You don't have God. You don't have the presence of the Lord. Somebody need to shout tonight. The only greatness we have is in Jesus Christ. I want you to say it. The only greatness we have is in Jesus Christ. He's our victory banner. It's victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise. That's right. That's right. That is right. Oh, hallelujah. Gideon started out with 32,000, didn't he? God said, hey, you got too many. And so when the dust settled, Gideon had how many left? 300. That's right. 300. And it was with those 300 that the Midianites were defeated. The Midianites were as numerous as the sand. That's a lot of people. You're going to You're gonna. How many people are you gonna reach Word of Life with the amount of people that you have? How many are you gonna reach? As many, as numerous as the sand. We limit ourselves. Why? Don't limit what God can do. God's big. This is bigger than just Silver Street. This is bigger than just Marion. He's a big God. Praise the Lord. 300 men. It wasn't because of their strength or numbers of men, but because of the strength and the power of God. The Bible said, it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Let's get back to the Holy Ghost. Let's get back to the Holy Ghost. Oh, church, let's get back to the Holy Ghost. Let's get back to the fire. Let's get back to Pentecost. Let's get back to depending on the Lord. Not by might nor by power, but it's by my spirit, says the Lord. It's not my might. It's not my strength. It's not me. It's God. It's the Lord. Hallelujah. It's God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm not going to almost finish this, but not quite. You know, with just a little boy's sack lunch, God takes and feeds over 5,000 people. You want to know what? God, nothing's impossible. I want to say that again. 5,000 people, a little sack lunch, 5,000. Listen, they had 12 baskets left over, just two loaves of bread, two loaves and five fish. Two loaves and five fish, and God feeds between 5,000 and 8,000 people. Two loaves of bread and five fish. Isn't that incredible? And if God can do that, surely God can meet your need. Surely God can heal you. Surely God can provide for you. Surely God can work the miracle in your life. If God can do that, praise the Lord. If you can just give God the little that you have and watch Him multiply it. Give him yourself and watch Him multiply it. Just turn yourself over to God and watch what God can do. I can't do anything with it, but you give it to God and God can multiply it. God can bless it. God can use it. God can make it last. Israel, their sandals never wore off. Their sandals for 40 years never wore off. Hallelujah. Isn't it incredible? Praise the Lord. Their clothes never wore out. In the desert 40 years, but yet God provided water out of a rock. Amen. They're hungry. God sent quail. They wanted bread. God sent manna, coriander seed. Like wafers, taste like honey. You know what those are? Nella wafers, that's what they were. Hallelujah. You ever had Nella wafers? Vanilla wafers? Huh? You ever had those? You ever had them with peanut butter on them? That's good too. You ever had them? No, this is what you do. You ready? This is what you do. You go get you from vanilla wafers, Nabisco. You got to get the name brand, okay? It's expensive, but you got to do it with these, okay? And you go get some Betty Crocker whipped frosting. My Lord. That's how I figured it was like in the desert. Amen. You know what I'm talking about? God provided supernaturally, folks. What about Elijah? When God told him there's a drought, he proclaimed a drought because of Jezebel and Ahaz and their rebellion and their apostasy and their wickedness and their darkness and bringing Israel into apostasy in the wrong direction. And so he declared judgment on them. Remember that? And then God told him to go to the brook Cherith. Remember that? Went to the brook Cherith and there was water there. So he had water supply. He had that. God brought him meat and bread in the morning and meat and bread in the evening by the ravens. The ravens. Isn't that incredible? Who told the ravens to do this? God did. That's right. Because I don't know about you, but I don't think Elijah spoke raven. Okay? I don't think he did. I don't think he spoke raven. No. Now, you talk about total trust. You talk about total dependency, how God met the need and God provided. But then there came a time when the brook dried up. Remember that? And so then God told them what to do. Go to Zarephath. And there'd be a widow woman there, and she'll provide for you. A widow woman who's about to cook her last meal and then die. God uses the most peculiar people and peculiar situation and peculiar things. A little is a lot when God is in it. It's incredible. And so God uses the things that you think that God wouldn't use or that you think that God can't use because there's only two loaves and five fish. But that's the way God's going to provide. Two loaves and five fish. But that's the way God chose. God was trying to teach Jesus, the disciples, to have total trust in him. And folks, I think God's trying to teach us the same thing. Have total trust, total trust, total trust. Don't worry. Don't fret. Trust God. Trust God. Doesn't mean you don't pray. You pray. Doesn't mean you don't cry out. You cry out, but you trust the Lord. God will meet it. God will provide it. A miracle. Amen. God will bring it. Praise the Lord. I believe that. But the thing is, I believe that God can bring the miracle. I believe that God wants to bring the miracle. I believe God wants to touch. I believe God wants to reveal his power and his glory to his people. I believe God wants to strengthen our faith and revive and renew our faith. I believe that. The problem is the church today no longer believes God for miracles. I'm going to talk to you. We don't believe anymore. I know we're churched, and I know we can say the right thing and the right Christian lingo. I understand that. But I'm not so sure we really believe what this book says, or maybe we believe what the book says, but we don't believe it for ourselves. We believe the Bible. We know that God created the heavens and the earth. God spoke it into existence. We know that God's all-powerful. We say it. We have the theology, but I'm not so sure we can believe it for ourselves now and today. Back then, yeah. Old Testament, yeah. New Testament, when Jesus was walking the earth, yeah, sure, no problem. But we're having difficulty believing it for now and today and for ourselves. The Bible says that God doesn't change. Praise the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Yes, ma'am.
Tanya's father
Yeah. Amen.
And my faith has God to keep me sustained.
Yeah.
He will do what his word says.
Amen.
When I believe and trust in him.
Yeah.
And until God's done, it ain't going to happen.
Right.
And when God's done, I'll be ready.
Right.
He knows best.
Right.
And right now, I'm walking that valley.
Yeah. 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 And you're pushing fear out. Because I know how that ugly thing tries to get in there. And you're like trying to cast that out of your thoughts, out of your mind. Okay, I get it. Right. Lord Jesus. Okay, so let's how about this, church? Let's believe for God for miracles. Let's believe again. I want to believe again. We can read. I got an office full of books of miracles I can read about. And I love them. And it does strengthen my faith. But how about for today and now? How about the miracle of the baptism of the Holy Ghost? What about the miracle of healing? What about the miracle of God providing? What about God taking two loaves of bread and five fish? And you know what I'm talking about? Listen, I know the gas prices never been so high. Inflation's never been so high. And guess what? You can get so caught up in that, you can get depressed. And what happens is, this is what the devil wants. Get your eyes on the inflation and not on God. Get your eyes on the gas prices and not on God. That's right. I know. Listen, I spent nearly $500 filling up, and I got $400, and I still got one more vehicle to fill up. That'll be $500 here. For just the vehicles in the church. You know that? And I know I could fret over that. I realize that I could fret over that. But you know what? We've been in this long enough. And we've been here long enough that whether inflation or no inflation, high gas prices, low gas prices, God is in control. And God provides. And God meets the need. God will do it. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So it's nothing to God. Oh, you look at, man, that's $200. Well, God says, well, that's nothing for me. Guess what, Mark? I own a cattle on a thousand hill. I'm bigger than the inflation. I'm bigger than the gas price. I'm bigger than the problem. So don't get your faith on this down here. Keep your faith on what's going on up there. And this book is in alignment with what's going on up there. You understand? This is in alignment with what's going on in heaven, the God of heaven. So be careful. I find myself getting drugged down sometimes. I get discouraged. I say, wait a minute. I got. I'm not listening to talk shows today. I'm listening to some preaching today. Okay. I want to be in the Word. You know. So okay, we got. I got to quit. Okay. Let's all stand together. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Strengthen your faith. One of my favorites. Yeah. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. I love it. God's good. Amen. All right now. I get it. I understand. Praise the Lord. Rhonda, good to have you tonight. All right, sister, God bless you. Praise God. Father God, as we come to you tonight in the name of the Lord, almighty God, we love you. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, I just feel your power and your presence tonight, Lord, in this Wednesday night service. What a blessing. What a blessing when God shows up. What a blessing with the anointing of the Lord. What a blessing of your word, Father. And I pray that I think you're speaking to all of our hearts together, myself included with the rest of the body of Christ, about believing God now for miracles, believing now, believing today, believing, Father, for what we pray for, standing on the word of God, not getting our eyes on what's going on down here and all the inflation and all the problems. People are a mess and people are problems because people are sinful. But help us keep our eyes on the God of heaven. Hallelujah. The God of eternity. The God who is our Lord and our Savior and our Redeemer and our Provider. So all these things that we're looking at down here, oh God, that's nothing for you. We will trust in you. God, you will make a way. You will provide. You will part the Red Sea. You will bring down Jericho walls. You will provide, Lord, like you did with Elijah. You will meet the needs with just two loaves of bread and five fish. You will do it, God, for you are an amazing, incredible God, and our God is Lord, and our God is all-powerful, and our God reigns, and our God's in control. The devil's not in control, but our God is, and we give God glory. We give God praise tonight. Hallelujah. And so we have a victory shout in this place. The walls come tumbling down. Hallelujah. 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 Revival's coming. Revival's coming. Revival's coming. Hallelujah. God's going to wake up his church. Oh, thank you, Lord. 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 Thank you, Father. God, we praise you tonight. God, we praise you. Hallelujah. Healing, provision, victory, power, forgiveness of sins. Oh, Father, you are the one that cleanses us of all sin, all unrighteousness. We give you praise and glory. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I don't know what to say, but thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. I'll tell you what. I'm not ending this service. You just take it on with you in your car, and you shout. You shout in the bus, you shout in the car, you shout in the home, you let them dogs and cats look at you like you're crazy, you just shout, you shout, you take it with you. Don't, we're not ending this tonight. You're going to take it with you, the spirit that's in here tonight, all right? And you just take that and you walk in that, all right? God bless you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Joy to worship you with all.